Good afternoon, honorable ministers and colleagues in the media. Thank you for your patience. We apologize for having kept you waiting for how long? 25 minutes. Today we have a very comprehensive briefing which will give you enough news content for 2 weeks. I will straight away hand you over to the Chief Secretary and the President.
Solar projects shall be undertaken at Tumbiza Hospital and at at 4 other health institutions in Mgokwe, Midlands province. The full compendium of projects approved by Cabinet, including under the macroeconomic stabilization and fiscal reform governance, inclusive growth and cross-cutting themes will be availed for the information of citizens in due course. Cabinet also heard the report on approved new place names. Cabinet received and approved new place names and street names as presented by Honorable Vice President Honorable Kembo Campbell Tukish Mohati as Chair of the Cabinet Committee on Place Names. Cabinet noted that through the process of naming, every community or society defines its identity and culture, tells its history, and espouses its values, beliefs, norms, and worldview. Naming is also a social engagement tool that fosters understanding, peace, and unity in diversity. In Harare, Cabinet approved the following name changes, among others: Emmerson Mnangagwa Road, formerly Enterprise Road; John Landangomo Avenue, formerly Selu Avenue; Joseph Msika Street, formerly Cameron Street; Solomon Juru Drive, formerly Kickman Drive; Oliver Tambo Avenue, formerly Livingstone Avenue; Fidel Castro Road, formerly Charter Road; and Leonid Brezhnev, formerly Fife Avenue. The second city Bulawayo Cabinet approved the following name changes, among others: Emmerson Dambuzo Mnangagwa Way, formerly 6th Avenue; Simon Mzenda Avenue, formerly 9th Avenue; Joseph Msika Avenue, formerly 12th Avenue; John Landangoma Avenue, formerly 4th Avenue up to King George; Maria Msika Avenue, formerly 5th Avenue; Nikita Mangena Avenue, formerly 10th Avenue; Queen Lozi K Street, formerly 5th Street and Queen's Road; Lookout Masubu Avenue, formerly Colin Granda Avenue; and Gyrostory Avenue, formerly 23rd Avenue. Furthermore, Cabinet approved the renaming of government composite office complexes as follows: Mganda and Njojo Building, formerly New Government Composite Office in Harare; Chingaira Makoni Building, formerly Immigration Building; Chinengundu Mashaya Mombe House, formerly Quality International Hotel; Mchane Kumalo Complex, formerly Education Services Center in Mount Pleasant; Salim Gabe Central Hospital, formerly Harare Central Hospital; and Chimoyo Camp Depot, formerly Tomlinson Depot. The following sub-national office blocks were also renamed: Ruth Chinamano House, formerly Cecil House in Harare; Stephen Jacqueline Omo Building, formerly Governor's Complex in Gwanda; Joanna Mafiana Ngomo Building, formerly Kezi District Office; Chokozile Matutu Building, formerly Wange District Office; Victoria Chitebo Provincial Hospital, formerly Mtare Provincial Hospital; and Mauti Mzenda Building, formerly Kutu District Complex. The full compendium of approved name changes will be availed for the information of citizens in due course. Following presentation on the grain importation and logistics report by the Minister of Home Affairs and Cultural Heritage as Acting Minister of Foreign Affairs and International Trade, Cabinet noted the need to ensure the continued availability of essential foodstuffs in the market and to counter the effects of the drought that was experienced during the 2018-19 agricultural season. Accordingly, Cabinet has resolved to implement the following temporary measures: removal of control of goods import permits for maize grain, maize meal, and wheat flour with immediate effect; placement of wheat flour on the open general import license with immediate effect; and suspension of all import duties currently applicable on the following products as indicated: wheat flour in packagings of more than 50 kgs. The current rate is 20% and the new rate will be 0%, so it will be exempt. Wheat flour in packagings of less than 50 kgs. Currently, the rate of duty is 10%. The new rate will be 0%. Maize meal, the current rate is 25%. The new rate will be 0%, so they are fully exempt. Millers and commercial users of grain are also hereby informed that following the pronouncements in the 2020 national budget, the subsidy on grains has been removed with immediate effect. In essence, all users of grain, including millers, will now buy grain at cost price, which currently stands at 4,000 Zimbabwe dollars for maize and small grains, and $8,612.08 for wheat per metric ton. Government will also be unveiling a mechanism for targeted subsidies for basic foodstuffs, particularly roller maize meal and bread flour, as outlined in the 2020 budget statement, once the final details of the mechanism are worked out. This is intended as an additional cushion for vulnerable households and the generality of Zimbabweans. Cabinet therefore wishes to assure the nation that all measures possible continue to be taken in order to ease the challenges of accessing food by all Zimbabweans. Cabinet received a detailed report on His Excellency the President's recent visit to Dubai, United Arab Emirates, which the Minister of Finance and Economic Development presented. The visit followed an invitation extended by the Vice President and Prime Minister of UAE, His Highness Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid Al Maktoum. It is significant that His Excellency the President's delegation comprised at least 25 business persons from Zimbabwe, as this resonates with the Second Republic's focus on efforts to revive the economy through engagement and re-engagement. Indeed, the message taken to the UAE was, Zimbabwe is open for business. Cabinet was informed that the business forum focused on entrepreneurship, tackling Africa's challenges in business, enhancing innovation in agriculture, and the rebuilding of food supplies, trade and investment facilitation, and power generation. It should be recalled that earlier in the year, the UAE donated a huge consignment of medical equipment and drugs for the benefit of Cyclone Idai victims, as well as a number of our health institutions. As relations with the UAE continue to scale new heights, Zimbabwe has appointed its first ambassador to the oil-rich nation and plans to set up an embassy in Dubai have made significant progress. Zimbabwe's ambassador is due to present his credentials to the UAE president today. Immense benefits from the president's visit abound for bilateral cooperation in sectors encompassing agriculture, agro-processing, mining, tourism, energy, infrastructure and services, and free trade zones. An opportunity was therefore taken during the visit to articulate the opportunities of doing business in Zimbabwe, including in the area of small and medium and startup enterprises. A lot of facilitation is being arranged in this regard. Cabinet was further informed that the Dubai Chamber of Commerce and Industry is expected to lead a business delegation of potential investors from the UAE to Zimbabwe in 2020 to scout for business opportunities in various sectors. Consideration is being made to extend visas at port of entry to citizens of the UAE. The Minister of Health and Child Care updated Cabinet on the industrial action by public hospital doctors and City of Harare nurses. The strike by the doctors over conditions of service has now gone beyond 77 days. Pertaining to the industrial action by the Harare City Council nurses, the situation at the municipal clinics remains constrained, as only 70 out of the expected 138 nurses are turning up for duty at the 6 municipal clinics. In order to ease the challenges associated with home-based deliveries, the Minister of Health and Child Care has, in conjunction with the Harare City Council Health Department, facilitated the opening of Edith Opperman Maternity Clinic. Nursing staff from Marara Hospital have been seconded to the Edith Opperman Maternity Clinic, which is open 24 hours. They will also be working with three sisters in charge, drawn from other city council clinics. Cabinet is cognizant that an agreement has been reached between the National Employment Council and the Nurses Trade Union for a salary increment for nurses. The nurses are therefore expected to return to work soon, but will not be paid for the days that they have not been reporting for duty. Disciplinary procedures for the striking nurses will definitely be conducted according to the law. Turning to hospital doctors, a total of 480 disciplinary cases have so far been heard. An additional 149 doctors were found guilty and discharged, bringing the cumulative total of the doctors discharged, to 435. Cabinet was informed of a meeting which was held on the 15th of November 2019 between the Minister of Health and Child Care representatives from the senior and junior doctors. Let me take this again. Cabinet was informed of a meeting which was held on the 15th of November 2019 between the Minister of Health and Child Care and representatives from the Senior and Junior Doctors Association. While positive strides were made at the meeting, with some doctors showing a willingness to return to work, Cabinet has resolved that those doctors already discharged have to apply for readmission. Government will not rescind its position on the fired doctors. Regarding accommodation provision for health services personnel, the Minister of National Housing and Social Amenities has informed Cabinet that his ministry is currently seized with a housing program to complement accommodation for health workers. This is the end of the brief in terms of the decisions reached today. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Honorable Chair. Now it's time we give to members of the media to pose any questions from the decisions made today in Cabinet. Any volunteers? Stand the ball rolling. Yes, please.
Thank you. My name is Leopold Munende from newzimbabwe.com. My first question, government has fired 435 doctors, that is a large number. How are we going to cover for these 435 doctors? And then on the new place names and street names, what exactly brought about this change in street names, and exactly what brought about the renaming of these street names in the president's name? Thank you.
Okay. Any other volunteer? Yes, please.
Thank you. Takushi Mbaku from Zimbabwe TV. My question is going to the Minister of Finance. We heard that there's a business delegation that's supposed to come in 2020. Dubai, but this year we've hosted a couple of nations. Remember Botswana, South Africa. A lot was said when the Botswana team came through, but how far have we gone regarding unlocking some of those deals that we put on the table? And will these delegations that are coming really come up with something tangible? Are we not just having talk shows? Secondly, on the grain imports and the wheat flour position that you've taken, to what extent will these measures affect pricing? If it's going to drop, do you have any projected estimates to say probably grain prices will fall by this percentage? Thank you.
Thank you. Another volunteer? Yes, please.
Hey, my name is Tosan Mole. I'm a freelance journalist. On final from the minister on the health aspect, how many deaths could have been recorded in recent months which could have been avoided by the strike, if any, there was any documentation I ask, so we have seen a number of bets being made from a home in Mbale, and the government has seen like applauding the woman who has been assisting. Has there been any records of still bets from the site, and as well as any recorded complications to the health of those women and their own children? And in general, does government applaud this heroic lady, I put the heroic in quotes, who is coming to assist?
Okay. Yes, please.
My name is Mujeta. I'm a freelance journalist. My question is related to what Chihambakwe said, and it also goes to the Minister of Finance. You know, based on the economic decline, you know, that we've experienced as a country since you took over as a Minister of Finance, there's a lot of skepticism as to the effectiveness and efficiency of your policies. You know, as we now turn over to a new year, you know, what guarantees do we have that we can see economic change based on the fact that, you know, since taking over, nothing visible has been experienced by the general public? And in that regard, even to your part, to the people in ZANU-PF, you know, some of the people in ZANU-PF are now saying that, you know, the president actually put you in MDC person. What do you have, you know, to those critiques of yours, you know, as we move to a new year?
This is not a subject for cabinet discussion, by the way, for the record.
Yeah, I was going to mention that we only take questions that relate to decisions of cabinet articulated by the chair of the ministerial team. Is this your first time in government? Where it comes? That's what I thought. So. So let me give one last one chance so that at least we can. Yes, please.
Good afternoon. My name is Theophilus Chuma. There was a mention that there was some bit of pushing visitors from the UAE. Now, this question is being posed to the chair, because you, the Ministry of Tourism is going to directly benefit from that kind of initiative. How do you project arrivals from Brussels market? Because the last time we spoke to the ambassador, he was projecting quite a significant increase in terms of tourism traffic to Zimbabwe. But how do you see such an initiative, boosting that kind of initiative, so that Zimbabwe can go down tangible growth levels from the UAE?
Thank you very much. We come to the end of the first session. Let me repeat back to the Honorable Chair. Take on the initiative to help the ministers respond.
Thank you so much for the questions. Now, with the privilege of chairing, I will make a suggestion that for some of the questions, particularly they are relating to the Minister of Health and Child Care, we expect that you will join us before we finish this session. I think there are some details that will require him specifically to attend to. Maybe with my colleagues, we might try and attend to some of the issues, but I would certainly request that you bear with us. He is finishing a meeting within this building. You will be joining us, I'm advised. So there was a question on how you're going to cover for the fire doctors. I think you will have a detailed response on that. I might not present it the best way you could. There is a question on what brought about the changes of names, but if I may get the person who asked it towards the end, he seemed to mentioned specifically the president. I didn't quite get the question towards the end. But as I was reading, there is a section that I would like to go through that before I explain further. In terms of the rationale behind renaming or naming of streets, it says, Cabinet noted that through the process of naming every community or society defines its identity and culture, tells its history, and espouses its values, beliefs, norms, and worldview. Naming is also a social engagement tool that fosters understanding, peace, and unity in diversity. When you look at the names that we have come up with, they are all speaking to these issues, to our history, to our values, and pretty much that is the reason why we thought it was important to take this route. In terms of naming streets or any building after the president, in terms of our constitution, he's the only person who can have a name after him, a street named after him while he's still alive. And this is not the first time you would recall that we had the same obtaining under the former president, President Robert Mugabe. I hope that addresses the issue. Minister of Finance, there is the question on what came out of the Botswana and South Africa meetings. I think there was something also as it relates to prices.
No, I think the question is what will come out of the UAE is that's the issue. And they're using the other countries as examples to say nothing came out, so why do we think something will come out this time around? Is that correct?
Yeah.
Fabulous, thank you. The relationship between Zimbabwe and UAE is very strong. It's very stronger every day. And they walk the talk, frankly, and promises. Now, you may not know this, that when Cyclone Idai struck, we were in UAE. And we obviously were to address the media in terms of the assistance we needed to give people that region relief and rebuild their lives. And the UAE responded. Within a week or so, they sent two plane loads of medicines. And some of those medicines were actually handed over to Mahuseka Hospital last year. Those medicines were from the UAE and some equipment. So they walk the talk, they follow through on promises, and I have no doubt that the delegation finds something to do here. Let me press on. Now, after the meetings this week, they've already sent someone as part of their from the UAE. That person arrived here yesterday, already in the country, already looking at scouting opportunities. Then they will send a delegation, which was from the multi sector, to now look into specific sectors. The tourism, which you already mentioned, is key. The mining sector is also critical. And manufacturing and the illicit logs, really right across sectors. Also, we are thinking of creating for us to share knowledge, because the project kind of experience in managing export processing zones. As you know, Dubai is not a huge, basically a huge export processing zone, frankly. And even now, even the process of winning for the rest of the world. So there's a lot to learn from it. So those kind of synergies will be wonderful going forward. Also, you know that you talk about maybe the relationship not being strong enough. Whether we like it or not, it's happening. The second largest importer of anything from Zimbabwe after South Africa is Dubai. The exports right now from Zimbabwe to Dubai are about $1 billion. And basically, some of that is gold, it's diamonds. So it's already a large trading partner, whether we like it or not. So there's no question that the relationship really moving to the next level. I think it's up to us to make sure that we're able to attract the investment from the UAE. And also, you know what, in summer, it does get very hot over there. If you think it gets hot over here, you try Middle East, it gets very hot. So naturally, people like to go somewhere where it's cool. So clearly, the tourism sector, which the acting minister has, is bound to benefit from investment from that region. Now, let me turn to the issue of opening up for imports, which in fact we announced last week, but this week we're following through with detail and emphasis on amplification. Now, if you're asking whether this would have an impact, well, obviously the price of wheat flour, but also the price of bread. Frankly, it is the intention to hold that this would have, first of all, a supply impact in terms of supply of these commodities as we move towards the festive season. But number two, an impact on the price as well. That's already increased supply we expect that to have an impact on the price downwards. So we're hopeful of this, but really at the end of the day, our job as government is to find ways, strategies for increasing the supply of basic commodities. And this is one strategy that, we have pronounced today. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Nune. The other question, again, is on health. The records of still beds, I think that will be very specific. With your indulgence, I will try and hold on to this question. Hopefully it comes before we finish. But I think there was discussion around how many deaths have been recorded. I want to believe this is specific to the lady who has been doing the midwifery part. And I think the response for that was none so far. That was known to the minister. Okay. And does government applaud the heroic acts by the lady? I will remove the quotes. You see, we have a Zimbabwean who has come to intervene in a situation where potentially there was a crisis and has saved so many lives. We know that much as we have advocated for former health institutions for people to use those facilities, we still have people who are delivering from home. And she is probably not the only one, except that she has done it at really a large scale. So most certainly, for the lives that have been saved, government will appreciate that. And I think the Minister of Health will explain further on this, but he is already planning to have a program for those who are delivering, helping people deliver from homes, to have some formal training on issues like sanitation and things like that. But he is the best person to respond on that kind of question. I will certainly not attempt to respond to the question that is on an issue which we did not discuss today. So I'll go to the last question, and I want to thank the Minister of Finance for already highlighting on key issues to do with tourism. So the first issue has to do with the visa application process. It is our intention that we make this as hassle-free as possible, and we are considering quite strongly prospects of them attaining visas at ports of entry, specifically at the airport. The Minister has highlighted that there are periods where it's very hot in Dubai or in the UAE in general, and they normally go out to cool off, and they've indicated that with the climate we have in Zimbabwe, it's, they will be willing to consider coming here. So it's up to us again to make sure that we put in place adequate facilities for that. So it's an issue that was discussed at length, and we believe that we will have more people coming from the UAE to visit Zimbabwe. We are also considering finding ways of having hotel infrastructure that is accommodating their religion and their preferences, and that is also seriously under consideration. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now we come to the last session of the questioning. Any volunteers? Yes, please.
My name is Zimbabwe from the Daily News. As a government, do you think firing the doctors is the remedy? I know you talk about the going through the normal process of the law, but is it the remedy to the situation that's deteriorating every day?
Okay, any other yes, please?
Thank you again. I just wanted to know when we will start calling these names, the new name, using the
yes.
As a follow-up to his response. response, his general response he gave on the the woman in Bali. I went there today, and in the narration, she gave quite a very terrifying experience in terms of what she's using in assisting these pregnant mothers. She said that she uses one razor blade to when separating the umbilical cord of a child, and we are fighting HIV and AIDS with a view to end it by 2030 as the world, and Zimbabwe since 2020 or 2024 as a year to reduce the pandemic and other related diseases. So really, I don't know, from my view, with given the kind of exposure these women are going through, having one razor blade, the infrastructure in which the beds have been done, the floor coldness and the hard surface on its own. I don't know, from the minister's perspective, should as a country, yes, we are brought here, but as a country, take a pet for yourself and say, this is where we are taking the country to.
No volunteer. So we, as we call it the end, let me get back to the ministers. Responses, Chair.
Thank you once again, and to thank those who have asked the questions. I still seem to be getting more questions relating to the Minister of Health and Child Care, and I kept hoping that he would walk in any minute. Is the firing of the doctors the remedy? The remedy is dialogue, which government has been open to from the start, and has opened all avenues to discuss issues, and has had to take the necessary, as you acknowledged, I don't think that, has acknowledged the necessary legal steps, which were followed to the latter. And this is always the last option, not the remedy. It is always the last option. The remedy is dialogue. I'm not sure if there are any other processes to be followed before new names are used, but to my understanding, this will be, as soon as they are put there, the banners, they will be ready for use. And on the midwife, towards the end, I didn't get the question. I think it was more of you telling us the ordeal. But I didn't quite understand that you is using one razor blade right across, which would be quite strange, though. But admittedly, the conditions will not be ideal, as I also highlighted, that the ministry is also considering assisting them with basic training, which, however, will not substitute the emphasis that it's important to use formal health institutions. I think in that issue, that's how far I can respond in terms of the knowledge that I have. Thank you.